जैतापकर बिल्डर्स अँड डेव्हलपर्स 20 वर्षांपासून गृहस्वप्न साकार करणारं एक नातं विश्वासाचं.
रिझर्व्ह रेपो दरात 25 बेसिस पॉईंटची कपात झाली असून रिझर्व्ह रेपो रेट 4.75% आला आहे. तर बाजारात चलनाचा तुटवडा जाणू देणार नाही. देशाचा विकास दर 1.9% राहण्याची शक्यता असून लघु उद्योग विकासासाठी गृहकर्ज वाहन कर्ज स्वस्त होण्याची शक्यता आहे. तर मायक्रो बँकिंग नाबार्ड NBHला मदत मिळणार असल्याची माहिती RBI गव्हर्नर शक्तिकांत दास यांनी दिली आहे. पाहुयात काय म्हणाले शक्तिकांत दास.
नमस्कार, good morning. Today humanity faces perhaps the trial of its time as COVID-19 grips the world with its deadly embrace. Everywhere, as also in India, the mission is to do whatever it takes to prevent the epidemiological curve from steepening any further. In this kind of an environment, the Reserve Bank of India has been very proactive and has been monitoring the situation very closely. The evolving situation is being monitored very closely, and you would have noticed that from time to time, almost every second day or third day, the Reserve Bank is coming out with certain announcements. Now, in this kind of environment, I thought it was necessary that I speak to a wider audience and convey the resolve of the Reserve Bank of India, our approach, and how we are going forward. Today, I propose to make certain announcements, and the statement is a bit long, as I said last time, because I have tried to make it as self-explanatory as possible, and so that there is adequate clarity. And since we are not able to hold a press conference, the meaning and the details are conveyed to the maximum extent possible. So, as I just said, everywhere, as also in India, the mission is to do whatever it takes to prevent the epidemiological curve from steepening any further. Human spirit is ignited by the resolve to overcome the pandemic. It is during our darkest moments that we must focus on the light. As Mahatma Gandhi said in his famous address at Kingsley Hall, London, in October 1931, and I quote Mahatma Gandhi, "In the midst of death, life persists. In the midst of untruth, truth persists. In the midst of darkness, light persists." Before I begin, I wish to place on record our gratitude to all the functionaries and personnel in the government, the private sector, banks, and other financial institutions who risk their lives on a daily basis by going to work or by working from home to fight the pandemic by keeping essential services fully operational. Our deepest appreciation goes out to doctors, healthcare and medical staff, police and law enforcement agencies who are at the front line. In the RBI, I would like to specially commend and thank our team of 150 officers, staff and service providers who are in quarantine away from their families and are at work 24/7 to keep essential services such as currency in circulation, retail and wholesale payments and settlement systems, reserve management, financial markets, liquidity management, financial regulation and supervision, and a host of other services available so that the nation may survive COVID-19. Banks and financial institutions have risen to the occasion and have ensured normal functioning. Their efforts are praiseworthy. I would like to thank my colleagues in the Reserve Bank of India who set aside personal health concerns and joined me in fashioning the array of measures taken by the RBI in the context of COVID-19. I also thank our teams for their intellectual support, analytical work and logistical arrangements. I would first like to highlight or give our assessment of the current economic situation. Since March 27, 2020, when I spoke to you last, the macroeconomic and financial landscape has deteriorated precipitously in some areas, but light still shines through bravely in some others. On April 14, the IMF released its global growth projections, revealing that in 2020, global economy is expected to plunge into the worst recession since the Great Depression, far worse than what had happened during the global financial crisis. The IMF's economic counselor has named it the Great Lockdown, estimating the cumulative loss to global GDP over 2020 and 21 at around $9 trillion, which is greater than the economies of Japan and Germany combined. Within this downturn, the projections are replete with even sharper declines in output in various countries. India is among the handful of countries that is projected to cling on somewhat tenuously to positive growth at 1.9%. In fact, this is the highest growth rate among the G20 economies as estimated by the IMF. The World Trade Organization sees world merchandised trade contracting by as much as 13 to 32%. I repeat, 13 to 32% in 2020. Global financial markets remain volatile and emerging market economies are grappling with capital flows and volatile exchange rates. Crude oil prices remain in a state of flux despite the agreement on production cuts by OPEC plus countries. For 2021, the IMF projects sizable V-shaped recoveries, close to 9 percentage points for the global GDP. India is expected to post a sharp turnaround and resume its pre-COVID, pre-slowdown trajectory by growing at 7.4% in 2021-22. Over the last 3 weeks, there have been a few data releases on domestic developments, but they are too disjointed to allow a comprehensive assessment of the state of economy. Yet, there are a few slivers of brightness among the encircling gloom. In my statement of March 27, I had referred to continuing resilience of agriculture and allied activities on the back of all-time highs in production of food grains and horticulture, with huge buffer stocks of rice and wheat far in excess of the buffer norms. By April 10, pre-monsoon kharif sowing had begun strongly with acres of paddy, which as you know is the principal kharif crop, up by 37% in comparison with the last season, that is in comparison with the kharif of 2019. States such as West Bengal, Telangana, Odisha, Assam, Karnataka and Chhattisgarh are leading in sowing activity despite the lockdown. On April 15, the India Meteorological Department IMD forecast a normal southwest monsoon for 2020 season, with rainfall expected to be 100% of the long period average. These are early developments and they bode well for our rural demand, supported as they are by accelerating fertilizer production, which was noticed up to February 2020. The robust growth of 21.3% in tractor sales up to February 2020 as against a contraction of 0.5% in the corresponding period of the previous year may provide an offset to farm labor shortage on account of the lockdown. In other production sectors, the situation is more somber. On April 9, the index of industrial production for February was released, showing that industrial output accelerated to its highest rate in 7 months. The impact of COVID-19 is not yet captured in these prints. So therefore, there is no reason to get misled by the IIP data which was released up to February, because the impact of COVID-19 comes thereafter. More tellingly, however, the revival in electricity generation, a coincident indicator of demand that had commenced from January 2020, has been halted by a sharp fall in daily demand in the range of 25 to 30% after the lockdown announcement on March 25th. Automobile production and sales, port freight traffic declined sharply in March, as recently released data indicates. The Manufacturing Purchasing Managers Index, that is PMI for March 2020, which was released on April 2, was the lowest in last 4 months. Notably, suppliers' delivery time lengthened for the first time in 5 months, indicating supply disruptions. The April 6 release showed that services PMI declined into contraction in March 2020, pulled down by a sharp downturn in export business, new domestic orders and employment. In the external sector, the contraction in exports in March 2020 at -34.6% has turned out to be much more severe than during the global financial crisis. However, amidst all this, the level of foreign exchange reserves which we have continue to be robust at US$476.5 billion on April 10th, equivalent to 11.8 months of imports. Turning to the status of banking operations since the nationwide lockdown was imposed by the Government of India, the RBI has taken a number of steps to ensure normal business functioning by the entire banking sector. As a result, payment infrastructure is running seamlessly. Banks have been required to put in place business continuity plans to operate from their disaster recovery sites and or to identify alternate locations for critical operations so that there is no disruption in customer services. Our data show that there was no downtime of internet or mobile banking. On an average, ATM operations stood at 91% of the full capacity. The average availability of business correspondents is over 80%. Regional offices of RBI have supplied fresh currency of ₹1,20,000 crores from March 1 till April 14th to currency chests across the country to meet increased demand for currency in the wake of COVID-19 pandemic. Banks have indeed risen to the occasion by refilling the ATMs regularly despite several logistical challenges. In my statement of March 27, I had indicated that together with the measures announced on March 27, the RBI's liquidity injection was about 3.2% of GDP since February 2020 MPC meeting. And as you would recall, the February MPC meeting, the announcements were made, if I recall correctly, on 6th of February. So from 6th February 2020 till March 27th, including the announcement made on March 27th, RBI had injected liquidity of an amount equivalent to 3.2% of our GDP. Since then, that is since March 27th, surplus liquidity in the banking system has increased sharply in the wake of sustained government spending. Systemic liquidity surplus as reflected in net absorptions. I am talking about net absorptions, that is the difference between the taking into account both the reverse repo and the repo. So therefore, the systemic liquidity surplus as reflected in net absorptions under the LAF averaged at about ₹4.36 lakh crore during the period March 27th to April 14, 2020. As announced on March 27, the RBI undertook three auctions of targeted term repo operations, that is TLTRO, injecting cumulatively ₹75,041 crore to ease liquidity constraints in the banking system and distress financial markets. Another TLTRO auction of ₹25,000 crore is being conducted today. In response to these auctions, financial conditions, now this is very important. In response to these conditions, financial conditions have eased. I correct myself. In response to these auctions, financial conditions have eased considerably as reflected in the spreads on money and bond market instruments. Moreover, activity in the corporate bond market has picked up appreciably with several corporates making new issuances. There are also some indications that redemption pressures faced by the mutual funds have also somewhat moderated. Against this background, and as I mentioned that we have been constantly monitoring the situation after considerable internal deliberation and after monitoring the evolving situation, and in our effort to see that the financial system is fully functional, the markets are fully functional, we have in RBI decided to announce certain additional measures, and I would now like to elaborate upon them. Against this backdrop, and based on our continuing assessment of the macroeconomic situation and financial market conditions, we propose to take further measures with the following objectives. One, to maintain adequate liquidity in the system and its constituents in the face of COVID-19 related dislocations. Two, facilitate and incentivize bank credit flows. Three, ease the financial stress, and 4, enable the formal functioning of markets. The first set of measures relate to liquidity management. The RBI has moved in a calibrated fashion to ensure conducive financial conditions and normalcy in the functioning of financial markets and institutions. The initial efforts to provide adequate system level liquidity are reflected in sizable net absorptions under the reverse repo operations. With this achieved, the RBI has undertaken measures to target liquidity provision to sectors and entities which are experiencing liquidity constraints and or hindrances to market access. That is, they have a difficulty in accessing the market and they have difficulty of having adequate liquidity with them. LTROs, that is long term repo operations, which we have undertaken. So these were meant to ensure adequate liquidity at longer end of the curve, longer end of the yield curve. Exemptions from the cash reserve ratio for equivalent incremental credit disbursed by banks as loans in certain select areas and targeted LTROs or TLTROs fall in this category. In this category or in this class and sector specific measures, it is observed that deployment of TLTRO funds so far has largely been to bonds issued by public sector entities and large corporates, especially in primary issuances. The disruptions caused by COVID-19 have, however, more severely impacted small and mid-sized corporates, including NBFCs and MFIs, in terms of their access to liquidity. So we have therefore decided to undertake what we call TLTRO operations 2, that is TLTRO 2.0. Accordingly, it has been decided to conduct targeted long-term repo operations TLTRO 2.0 for an aggregate amount of rupees 50,000 crore to begin with. Please mark my words, rupees 50,000 crore to begin with in tranches of appropriate sizes. Based on our assessment of the evolving situation and based on the pattern of utilization of this 50,000 crore by the market and in the market, it is always open for RBI to step up this amount beyond 50,000 crores as per requirement or as may be necessary to see that various segments of the market, various segments of the, you know, the MFIs, the NBFCs and other institutions, in terms of liquidity, they remain well lubricated. The funds availed by the banks under TLTRO 2.0 should be invested in investment grade bonds, commercial paper and non-convertible debentures of NBFCs, with at least 50% of the total amount availed going to small and mid-sized NBFCs and MFIs. So therefore, the emphasis will be to see that there is adequate flow to the mid-size and the small NBFCs as well as to the MFIs. The guidelines in this regard will spell out the relevant details. These investments have to be made within 1 month of the availment of liquidity from RBI, as in the case of the earlier TLTRO auctions which have been conducted so far. Investments made by banks under this facility will be classified as held to maturity HTM even in excess of 25% of total investment permitted to be included in HTM portfolio. Exposures under this facility are also not to be reckoned under the large exposure framework, and the notification for TLTRO 2.0 auction will be issued today. The next announcement relates to refinancing facilities for All India financial institutions like NABARD, SIDBI and the National Housing Bank. All India financial institutions such as NABARD, SIDBI and National Housing Bank play an important role in meeting the long-term funding requirements of agriculture and the rural sector, small industries, housing finance companies, MFIs and NBFCs. These All India financial institutions normally raise resources from the market through specified instruments which are allowed by the Reserve Bank of India, in addition to, of course, relying on their own resources. In view of the tightening of financial conditions in the wake of COVID-19 pandemic, these institutions are today facing difficulties in raising resources from the market. Accordingly, it has been decided to provide special refinance facilities for a total amount of rupees 50,000 crores to NABARD, SIDBI and NHB to enable them to meet sectoral credit needs. This will comprise of rupees 25,000 crore to NABARD for refinancing regional rural banks, that is RRBs and cooperative banks and microfinancial institutions. Rupees 15,000 crore will flow to SIDBI for on-lending and refinancing, and as you know, SIDBI will be lending this money to, you know, by way of providing refinance to scheduled commercial banks as well as to other financial entities, NBFCs, MFIs, etc., who sanction loans to the MSME segment of the economy. And NHB will be allotted rupees 10,000 crore for supporting housing finance companies, HFCs. Now, these amounts which I announced, that is totally 50,000 crore, of which 25,000 crore goes to NABARD, 15,000 crore goes to SIDBI, and 10,000 crore goes to NHB. These amounts have been determined and decided in consultation with these institutions. Should there be additional requirement by these institutions, and again, depending on and based on the actual utilization of resources provided, funds provided by the, or the liquidity provided by the RBI. If there is a further requirement, the RBI will assess the situation, review it and take further measures to step up this level of liquidity support. Advances under this facility will be charged at RBI's policy repo rate at the time of availment. So, these institutions get it today as per the, you know, the repo rate, which is 4.4%. So, therefore, this will enable these institutions to provide the refinance at an affordable rate, at a reasonable rate, you know, when they extend this money to various lending institutions. The next announcement, and this is very important, relates to the LAF, Liquidity Adjustment Facility, and this relates to fixed rate reverse repo rate, that is the reverse repo rate. As I have mentioned earlier, the surplus liquidity in the banking system has risen significantly in the wake of government spending and the various liquidity enhancing measures undertaken by the RBI. On April 15, the amount absorbed under reverse repo operations was 6.9 lakh crore. Earlier, what I had given about the system liquidity, that was net, that is the difference between the repo and the reverse repo. What I am now saying is one way of flow at the end of every day, how much flows from the system into the RBI through the reverse repo window, that has been in the order of, you know, on April 15th, the RBI absorbed rupees 6.9 lakh crore through the reverse repo window. So, that much of surplus was available with the system. Now, in order to encourage the banks to deploy these surplus funds in investments and loans in productive sectors of the economy, it has been decided to reduce the fixed rate reverse repo rate under the liquidity adjustment facility by 25 basis points from 4% to 3.75% with immediate effect. So, I repeat, the reverse repo rate is being reduced by 25 basis points from 4% to 3.75%. The policy repo rate, however, remains unchanged at 4.4%, because that is a matter which is decided by the MPC, and also the marginal standing facility rate and bank rate, they also remain unchanged at 4.65%. The next announcement relates to ways and means advances for states. On 1st April 2020, RBI had announced an increase in the ways and means advances limit, WMA limit of states by 30%. It has now been decided to increase the WMA limit of states by 60% over and above the level as on March 31st, 2020 to provide greater comfort to the states for undertaking COVID containment and mitigation efforts and also to plan their market borrowing programs better. This we expect will help the states not to bunch up their borrowing program in the early part of the year, but to space it appropriately as per their requirement. The increased limit will be available, that is this increased limit of WMA up to by 60%. This facility will be available till September 30th, 2020. The next set of measures are related to regulatory measures. on March 27, 2020, the Reserve Bank had announced certain regulatory measures to mitigate the burden of debt servicing brought about by disruptions on account of COVID-19 and to ensure the continuity of viable businesses. Based on a review of rapidly evolving situation and consistent with globally coordinated action committed to by Basel Committee on Banking Supervision to alleviate the impact of COVID-19 on global banking system, additional regulatory measures are being announced today. So whatever regulatory measures we are announcing, they are consistent with the Basel guidelines. The first measure under this category of regulatory measures, they relate to asset classification. Economic activity has come to a standstill during the period of the lockdown. Now, as I go with these announcements, I request your patience, because in the concluding paragraphs, in the concluding two or three paragraphs to which I will come very shortly, I have attempted to give some kind of a forward guidance on certain aspects. So I request your patience. I repeat, economic activity has come to a standstill during the period of the lockdown, with consequential lingering effects which have unambiguously affected the cash flows of households and businesses. On March 27, the Reserve Bank had permitted lending institutions to grant moratorium of 3 months on payment of the current dues falling due between 1st March and May 31st. It is recognized that the onset of COVID-19 has also exacerbated the challenges for such borrowers even to honor their commitments which have fallen due on or before February 29, 2020 in standard accounts. The Basel Committee on Banking Supervision has taken cognizance of the financial and economic impact of COVID-19 and very recently announced that the payment moratorium periods, public or granted by banks on a voluntary basis relating to COVID-19 outbreak, can be excluded by banks from the number of days past due in respect of NPA recognition. Therefore, it has been decided that in respect of all accounts for which lending institutions decide to grant moratorium or deferment and which were standard as on 1st March 2020, the 90-day NPA norm shall exclude the moratorium period. That is, there would be an asset classification standstill for all such accounts from 1st March to 31st May 2020. NBFCs which are required to comply with Indian Accounting Standards Ind AS may be guided by the guidelines duly approved by their boards and as per the provisions and as per the advisories of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India in recognition of impairments. In other words, NBFCs do have the flexibility under the prescribed accounting standards to consider such relief to their borrowers. At the same time, we are cognizant of risk build-up in banks' balance sheets on account of firm-level stress and delays in recoveries. With the objective of ensuring that banks maintain sufficient buffers and remain adequately provisioned to meet future challenges, they will have to maintain a higher provision of 10% on all such accounts under the standstill spread over two quarters. That is March, that is the quarter ending March 2020 and June 2020. These provisions can be adjusted later on against the provisioning requirements for actual slippages in such accounts. You see, while we are announcing certain forbearances, etc., for the banks, Reserve Bank as the regulator of the banking system has to ensure that our banks remain financially healthy over a period of time and in the long term. So therefore, while announcing certain prudential relaxations, we have to necessarily see that the banking system also remains healthy. So therefore, we have required them to make certain provisions and we are saying that these provisions can be adjusted later on against provisioning requirements for actual slippages. So only if the slippage doesn't arise, then the banks have adequate flexibility to sort of deal with their appropriately deal with it in their accounts. The next announcement relates to extension of resolution timeline. Under RBI's prudential framework of resolution of stressed assets dated June 7, 2019, in the case of large accounts under default, scheduled commercial banks, All India Financial Institutions, NBFCs which are non-deposit taking but systemically important, and deposit taking NBFCs are currently required to hold an additional provision of 20% if a resolution plan has not been completed within 210 days from the date of such default. Recognizing the challenges to the resolution of stressed assets in the current volatile environment, it has been decided that the period of resolution plan shall be extended by 90 days. The details of this announcement will, of course, be spelled out in the circular which will be issued. The next announcement relates to distribution of dividend. It is imperative that banks conserve capital to retain their capacity to support the economy and absorb losses in an environment of heightened uncertainty. It has therefore been decided that in view of the COVID-19 related economic shock, scheduled commercial banks and cooperative banks shall not make any further dividend payouts from profits pertaining to the financial year ended 31st March 2020 until further instructions. This restriction shall, however, be reviewed on the basis of the financial position of banks for the quarter ending September 30, 2020. The next announcement relates to LCR, liquidity coverage ratio. The Reserve Bank, and this is the, you know, this is a norm which has been prescribed for the banks, as you would know. Reserve Bank has been proactively taking measures to address systemic liquidity issues through a slew of monetary and market operations. In order to ease the liquidity position at the level of individual institutions, the LCR requirement for scheduled commercial banks is, we have now decided that the LCR requirement of scheduled commercial banks will be brought down from, it is being brought down from 100% to 80% with immediate effect. I repeat, LCR requirement is being brought down from 100% to 80% with immediate effect. The requirement shall be gradually, however, restored back in two phases, 90% by 1st October 2020 and 100% by 1st April 2021. The next announcement relates to NBFC loans to commercial real estate projects. In terms of extant guidelines for banks, the date for commencement of commercial operations, DCCO, in respect of loans to commercial real estate projects, delayed for reasons beyond the control of promoters, can be extended by additional 1 year over and above the 1 year extension permitted in the normal course without treating the same as restructuring. And restructuring, as you know, would obviously have implications for asset classification. It has now been decided to extend a similar treatment to loans given by NBFCs to commercial real estate. This will provide relief to NBFCs as well as to the real estate sector. Now, before I go to the concluding remarks, let me mention that the RBI, as I mentioned earlier, is monitoring the situation very closely. We are very vigilant about the developments, and whenever required, we will make necessary announcements. And so therefore, this is not the last of the announcements that we are announcing today to deal with the situation. As the situation warrants, we will be announcing new measures to deal with the challenges. Our effort is always to remain proactive and also to respond to the emerging challenges. Now, let me now move to the concluding portion of my remarks. In conclusion, I would like to review recent developments relating to inflation and the outlook without infringing in any way the mandate of the Monetary Policy Committee. The press release of National Statistics Office NSO on April 13, 2020 showed that CPI inflation for March 2020 declined by 70 basis points to 5.9%. This is, however, based on data gathered up to 19th March. The data showed a softening of food inflation by around 160 basis points on account of the easing of prices of vegetables, eggs, meat, fish, pulses, etc. In other categories of CPI inflation, pressures remained firm. Daily data on 22 essential food items covered by the Department of Consumer Affairs of Government of India suggest that food prices have increased by 2.3% in April so far, that is up to April 13th, in a broad-based manner. Though onion prices have continued to decline, and at the same time, the PDS kerosene prices have slumped by 24% in the first fortnight of April. Domestic LPG prices also declined by 8%. These early developments suggest that inflation is on a declining trajectory, having fallen by 170 basis points from its January 2020 peak. In the period ahead, inflation could recede even further, barring of course any supply side disruption shocks, and may even settle well below the target of 4% by the second half of 2021. Such an outlook would make policy space available to address the intensification of risks to growth and financial stability brought about by COVID-19. This space needs to be used effectively and in time. The RBI, as I said earlier, will monitor the evolving situation continuously and use all its instruments to address the daunting challenges posed by the pandemic. The overarching objective is to keep the financial system and financial markets sound, liquid and smoothly functioning, so that finance keeps flowing to all stakeholders, especially the vulnerable and the disadvantaged. Regulatory measures that have been announced so far, including those which are announced today, are dovetailed into the objective of preserving financial stability. Although social distancing separates us, we stand united and resolute. Eventually, we are confident that we shall cure and we shall endure. Thank you very much.
कोकणातल्या ताज्या घडामोडी सर्वप्रथम पाहण्यासाठी सबस्क्राइब करा कोकणचं महाचॅनल सिंधुदुर्ग लाईव्ह यूट्यूब चॅनल, आणि ताज्या घडामोडी पाहण्यासाठी बेल आयकॉनवर क्लिक करा.